Vincent Kimusop and Marcus Agenga from the Institute of Election Democracy. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for joining us. Today is D-Day. All the political rhetoric that has been going on, all the political machinations and alignments basically culminate to today as Kenyans go out. Let me start with you, Marcus, as an observer. First of all, what your thoughts are on the progress so far?
First of all, let me clarify that I'm from the Election Observation Group, ELOG, and we are monitoring the elections today. You're observing the process. We have deployed 8,000 observers across the country, and we are receiving information, even as we speak now, about what's happening
all over
the country. And the first messages we have received this morning is regarding the setup and the opening process of the polling stations. And across the country, we are recording that there's generally a good start. Of course, with a few issues here and there.
Which I expected, I guess.
Which are expected, of course. So we hope they'll even up as we move to 9 a.m. Yeah.
All right. Nerima, you've been seeing what's going on, your observations so far, and anything you'd like to comment regarding what has happened so far?
Yes, so far it's encouraging to see the long lines of people who are anticipating this election. So there's definitely a mood of wanting to participate, and that's very encouraging. It's very early in the morning, and we've already been able to see such large crowds. So I'm looking forward to the rest of the day.
Okay. Vincent, it might be too early to tell whether there's voter apathy, but looking at and judging from the cues that we've seen so far.
I think what we have seen and the word apathy, they are two worlds apart. Eh? And I think watching one, in addition to what my colleague has said, I think for me what I'm excited is the interview that happened at the Greens Park Mall. The lady who spoke, feeling that our decision has to count, that elections is an opportunity for us to contribute towards changing and shaping the destiny of our country. And actually, when she concluded, all the people around her were in agreement with the sentiments that she... What better way of really seeing the mood and the opinion on the ground, and just seeing the overall the views? I'm happy that you've gone from Machakos, Busia, Nyeri. There's a good view of what is happening within the nation. So it is impressive. Kenyans have turned up. They have seen that elections that matter. And Abraham Lincoln said that elections belong to the people. Whatever decisions they make, they will live up to them. And I want to commend Kenyans. I think this is a day that we should be proud of. And we really are happy as Kenyans. Our people are participating in shaping their destinies.
All right, Marcus, I'm sure you're getting reports as we're going along, as you've mentioned. And given that there was a lot of talk about IEBC not being ready and them not being set up, do you get the confidence, even from what you're getting on the ground, that they are actually ready and they are ready to deliver a credible election?
I think we also need to understand where this IEBC is coming from. I think they came into office hardly 8 months to a general election. And I think from ELOG's point of view, they have done...
Although the IEBC has been there for the last 5 years.
It's the commissioners that came in.
And we do have a secretariat that should have been running all through.
So, in fact, from where we sit, there was no vacuum, there was no gap.
Correct.
And this has been demonstrated by IEBC's commitments to ensuring that there is a credible process. However, as you also know, that there have been a lot of legal tussles that they had to undergo to ensure that the process is credible. But I think from where we sit as observers group, we think IEBC is doing their part, and we hope to see our Chebukati's team will do something different.
Okay.
Yeah.
Nerima, one of the things that is very unique to this election is the number of youth who are on the ballot as, you know, contenders. That, of course, is indicative of a new dawn for Kenya.
Absolutely. I mean, the classic example is Nandi, where, of course, we're seeing a youth going for a governor's seat and he's not even 35. Or we can even talk about Muthiora Kariara standing up to be a deputy president, and he's 27 years old. And we can also talk about Nairobi, Senator Silentoi going for that aspirant seat.
Starehe,
and
she's, where you have
yes,
of
all
youth.
Of them right. are youth. So it's quite encouraging to see that young people want to be engaged during this process and they do want to participate and perhaps elect young people to represent them within these parties in parliament.
Okay, what do you think they're bound to infuse into the new government, hoping that, you know, a good number of them are going to be elected? What is it that we should expect from them as a youth?
I believe freshness of ideas. They're specific. They'll be able to also be specific to issues that young people are facing. As much as the two political bigwigs have been presenting their manifestos, youth has sort of been a back burner to them, sort of been a by the way. But when you have young people within these positions, they are able to articulate what their issues are and also come up with creative solutions. You cannot be leading a country of 70% young people when you don't have them representative on your policy-making tables and negotiation.
All right. Vincent?
Interestingly, one of the presidential candidates, Professor Wainaina, his slogan was to youthify
and modernize
Kenya. I don't know why. I know we should. You're the one asking us questions. I wanted to Nerima to speak. How comes the youth have not resonated with such a message? So we really need to unpack why somebody who championed the cause of the youth and not campaigning really for him, but just asking, where is the disconnect? Why are we not seeing the relations between the issues of the youth and maybe a course that was at the top, at that level? And I think maybe the youth still have a long way to cover, that as they engage in the MCA, Member of Parliament, even women rep, then with time we'll start seeing this ideological politics. I'm impressed myself with what is happening with Starehe, and as we said yesterday, that you actually, like Mbogo stands on an ODM ticket. It is it's a Jubilee stronghold, and you've not seen the young people fighting among each other because of the parties they represent. So there is hope for this country, and it's encouraging to see youth participate in the election. I just wanted to point out something that also when we even the media has given really the youth the platforms to articulate and share the issues. We're seeing the even your reporters, that they are not only journalists, they are also youth themselves. So I think there is progress in the country, and there are things we ought to celebrate as a people.
All right. Nerima, maybe coming back to you, the youth have previously been used a lot in terms of violence, or viewed as agents of being used in violence. But looking at even the queues that we had, one of the messages that was coming out from all and sundry was, we are out here to vote, but whoever wins, whoever loses, we still have a country. Possibly this message maybe has got to Kenyans finally.
Yes, I believe that it has, because there have been a lot of peace messages. We've been seeing them over and over for the last few months. But at the end of the day, young people have issues such as unemployment. That's a major issue for many young people. Mm. As much as we see people recite it, we actually have friends who've not worked for up to 3 years, still living with their parents and depending on them for a cost of living or even for food. So when we even had the issues of unga, a lot of us can't even not only just buy that unga, we don't buy it on our own. It's our parents who supply that unga for us. And then we also talk about the education. We also had teachers on strike, lecturers on strike. We can even talk about the doctor's strike, the nurses' strike, which is still ongoing. So we do understand that definitely there are issues in our country. And for a lot of young people, what they want is change. Change from the narrative of where we are now and change to a better country. Mm. So for them, it's about identifying people who can have those solutions on the table for them.
All right, Marcus, of course, with the numbers that we have seen so far and with some of the polling stations experiencing some delays and technical hitches, possibly your message as an observer to Kenyans as they go out there, because one thing that we must exercise is patience. Mm.
I think there should be hope that in some parts of the country, the process is already ongoing. And just to give the officials some time to put the house in order, and that, as you've said rightly, that we need to be patient with the commission, we need to be patient with the presiding officers in different polling stations, and let us see what happens. But I think in where there are necessary delays, where there are serious issues, those should come out and to be addressed by relevant authorities.
All right.
But of course, even as observations group, we'll be issuing our statement in the next 1 hour to be able to give the country a feel of what we have observed since 6 a.m. So the next 1 hour, you'll be watching us give our first election statement.
All right, and as we can see there, we have live pictures of Joseph Ndadhi, who is a gubernatorial aspirant, basically going to cast his vote. And we can see that happening right there as we continue to bring you live coverage, which is coming from different parts of this country. We have our reporters in the 47 counties and ensuring that we bring you details of things as they happen. But let me come to you, Vincent, and this being the second election that we're having under the new constitution. Mm. Now, Kenyans understand more practically what devolution is all about. Mm. Kenyans understand what the role of a governor is, at least more than we did previously. How is that likely to impact this particular election in terms of people choosing the right leaders?
You see it at two levels. Like the MCA position, there is one of the quads where the ballot paper for the MCAs is going to be all close to a meter. So, as in that in itself, that indicates. Long ballot paper is an indication of how serious interest this position of an MCA has attracted. And then the other thing that also we start seeing is that credit to devolution is why we will not have major incidences of violence is devolution has reduced and given people hope that, hey, we can actually are still able to get our cake even if we are not part of the government. So devolution has reduced the tension. There's still a lot of interest on the presidential one, but with time, Mike, I can point out to you that Kenyans are very concerned about who is my MCA, who is my governor. As we, when you saw the presidential debate, that of course I wish it had been successful, but also people met in different caucuses, universities. People wanted to know who is my MCA, what do you stand for. That for me, which is a civic-led process owned by the people, tells you very well that if there is something Kenyans are not ready to do away with, is actually do away with the devolution. And that's why you saw in the manifestos devolution featured prominently in pointing out that it's going to be a platform for delivery. So devolution is critical. And you can even see the way the seats, even the ballot papers are organized. At the heart of it is that the third paper is the one for the MCA, and the last one is the one for governor. So these people do not want to get this wrong. We can get wrong on the presidency, but for MCA and the governor, there is a lot of interest, which reduced the interest for the position of senator and the one for the member of parliament. Mm.
All right, Marcus, voter education, of course, might be one of the reasons why we have a very upbeat electorate that has come out in numbers, and possibly the difference between 2013 and now in terms of just voter awareness of what is going on and why it is important for them to exercise that democratic right.
I think voter education plays a key role in a number of ways. And I think you remember one of the recommendations from the bipartisan committee on IBC was that, and also subsequently found its way in the Elections Law Amendment Act of 2016, is about voter education. And I think what we have observed ourselves as an observer group is that there has been an effort by a number of stakeholders to upscale voter education. Because if you remember, in 2013, we had a number of spoiled votes, if you remember the last time, and we hope that this won't be the case this time round. So I think why we see a number of changes, even in the voter turnout, is because this election means a lot of things to many people. For the opposition, this would be history in the making. For the ruling coalition, again, this is history in the making. So we hope that to see, as we progress today, to see how that voter education that has been done by a number of stakeholders, the civil societies, the faith-based organizations, the IBC itself. They have done serious amount of civic education, and I want to see how that translates.
Reflect on translate. Yeah. Nerima, you interact a lot with the youth on Siasa Place, and of course, we've already mentioned that we have a number of young people who are on the ballot paper to be elected, seeking elective seats. Is that likely to be reflected on the youth who are actually coming out to vote?
It's a mixture of both, because we've been hearing youth who are very excited about the whole voting process and participating. And then we have that group of young people who, I think I read an article where somebody said that the youth are not loyal. Well, when it comes to, when it was during the campaign season, whoever it was, may it be Jubilee, NASA, they went and supported them at that campaign rally. And they went mainly because of their merchandise or perhaps voter bribery. Mm. So there's also that clamp of where we're not quite sure where they're going to line up or if they're going to line up today and who they're going to vote for. But in the same speaking token, we can also talk about young people who do want to be concerned about the process, those who are now beginning to understand that we must have issue-based kind of politics. And that's the only way that we're going to be able to see that change. But why I believe that this election is important is because even though we've been receiving opinion polls from different companies, the one thing that remains similar is how close the race is. This is one of those elections where literally each vote counts. It will determine which counties follow into which party affiliation. So in this election period, we do need to turn out in large numbers. And that's why we began to see political leaders calling out on the youth to turn out in large numbers to support them.
And I mean, the youth are a huge constituency. They're 51% of the registered voters, and that's a huge voice. Vincent, do you feel that they are fully engaged and completely understand how important this is for them, even for the future?
Now I'm speaking here from at the meso level, because you can start micro, macro, and then at the highest level, the meso level. Not really, because as much as they are the people who can tilt and affect the vote, yet you do not see those numbers translated into policy intentions and commitments on the part of the parties. So for me, what I see, the youth are only being engaged at the political level because of the interest they have on their vote. But when it comes to areas and things that matter, the youth are not there. The youth don't have money to contribute to political parties. And that's why you don't see them impacting decisions. And even just look at the manifesto and look at what the sections on the youth, when you see the depth and the details that is given matching to the needs of the youth, you do not see that much. So in my view, what the youth needs to do is that they need to translate their numbers into power, in the sense that what are you promising us as a youth constituency, and how are we seeing that in look at the number, even positions. I can tell you it's very unlikely that we any of the candidates who will win will appoint a youthful person to be a minister of finance, because that is a ministry that matters. It's the one that controls the rest. They will be in peripheral positions, and we have to tell the youth that it's because of your disorganization, and that's why you're not where things matter.
Nerima seems to disagree with you.
Well, I agreed with Vincent until the last point about it is because of your disorganization. Because even if we look at our larger political parties, there are youth who are involved. In fact, majority of the people who support our party are the youth. However, when you look at positions such as the youth wing, you will find that a lot of them have been choked out of leadership positions. So we've also seen an increase of independent candidates, because youth are beginning to figure out that perhaps using party systems is not somewhere where they are welcome, and they rather go on their own agendas independent and go and fight in that position.
And that's
position.
Why I'm saying, Nerima, that when it comes now to influencing, you know, raw power where decisions are made, the person who gives one, who does an EFT to a political party has more influence in the decisions of whichever formation, unlike the youth that had the numbers to even get the person in power. So there is a mismatch between the high number of number of voters and the impact it has on the table and in the decisions. And that's why it's good to lay these issues before the youth so that they are able to demand more for their numbers.
All right. And let me come to you, Marcus. And you probably have observed quite a number of elections in different places. But Kenya is unique in the sense that we elect six elective posts in one day. And of course, that is bound to have challenges. But we're going to take a break and we'll come back on this. Or rather, we are going to listen in to Anyang Nyong'o, who is giving a prayer.